Milo just retired in Houston, although he still works for the Astros, and he does a weekly radio show on baseball, and he will be doing selected games this year. In fact, you're going to Detroit. Want to tell our fans why you're going to Detroit?
I've never been there to do a baseball game since I was with the Astros. And when I went to play them in Interleague a few years ago, it was the weekend of my daughter's funeral, so I missed that. So I want to be there this year. Give me 60 ballparks. It is a record. 60 big league ballparks.
That'll be his 60th venue. And that is unquestionably a major league record. 60 ballpark, 59 that he has now as a record, because Vin, the great Vin Scully, has done the National League, except for there's some interleague games. Milo did the White Sox and did a lot of American League clubs and the Cubs. What is your fondest memory? We'll take the White Sox first. What's your fondest memory of being a White Sox announcer?
Well, I think it was 65 when we went into first place on Labor Day at Baltimore. We had just swept the Yankees and gone to Baltimore, went into first place, and we just had September to go, and I really thought that Al Lopez's club was going to make it all the way to the big show. But a few days later, on Labor Day, we played a doubleheader at Old Comiskey. The doubleheader had 19 innings in the second game, I believe. So we got into Washington, D.C. the next morning for a Labor Day doubleheader, and a doubleheader against Washington, two guys who had not won a game between them since May, beat us a doubleheader, and to prove it wasn't a fluke, 8 days later at Old Comiskey, those same two pitchers in a makeup twilight doubleheader beat the Sox again, and all the scores were 2-1, and they never recovered from that, and the Twins went right by, but I thought that club 65 should have been in the World Series.
Well, another near miss for the Sox of that era. They had great teams in the early to mid-60s, right through 67. Your Cubs announcing years, you worked with the great Jack Brickhouse. You worked with some fabulous athletes. Dallas Green was the GM 3 years after you got there. What do you remember from the Cubs? Was it the 84 division?
Well, I think I remember when I went to the Cubs first in 55.
Oh, that's right.
With Bert Wilson. And was a part of the no-hitter by Sad Sam Toothpick Jones when he walked the bases loaded in the ninth inning and then struck out Dick Grote, Roberto Clemente, and the first Frank Thomas to preserve the no-hitter. And then, of course, when I got over to the Sox, one of my biggest memories other than the one we just talked about was when Early Wynn was going for his 300th win in 62. And he needed 8 wins, and he was at 299 by the All-Star break. So we figured, oh, he's going to have it anytime. Well, 6 weeks later, old Gus was still on 299, and we're going to play the Boston Red Sox at Comiskey, and they were known as the Country Club Red Sox. And we figured, hey, it's a cinch. He's going to win 300 tonight. We'll pass out all the memorabilia with a pin and his Cy Young Award book and all the things. It was a heck of a game, Tom. 2 hours. The only problem was he pitched a heck of a game. The final score was 1-0, but a rookie by the name of Bill Mambo Kett pitched a no-hitter as a rookie, scored the only run of the game, and that kept Wynn from winning 300. He got it next year at Kansas City. But those are some of the things. And Court, Pete Ward being here tonight with all those guys, Gary Peters, and oh, I love that club. They were a bunch of great guys. And really glad to see Pete come out here tonight. He really didn't know he was going to be here, but I was glad you introduced him.
I saw him at Sox Fest. I said, Pete, we want you. And he came out, and the first thing he said was, where's Milo? Tony La Russa said the same thing. Y'all excited to have you here.
Let me make one quick note about Tony, if I may, and then Goose. Tony, when I was with the Braves, was with us for nine games in 71. He played third base, shortstop, and second base, and then he was gone. And recently, when I was down by the batting cage, I wanted to get down and say goodbye to him because I didn't know when I'd ever see him. esteem again. Thank goodness he's here tonight. But his owner, Mr. DeWitt, was standing there, Tony, if you remember. And you looked at Mr. DeWitt, and he said, you know, Milo, when he saw me play in 71 with the Braves, was the first guy to name me a suspect, not a prospect. And he knew that wasn't true. But I want to tell you something about Tony. And I think it was our connection with Al Lopez, fellow folks from Tampa, that we really had something going. We always looked each other up when we played. And I can tell you this, when I would introduce him at opening nights or playoff games, he always waited for me after the game in the runway to thank me for treating him so kindly and so well. And he's always been a favorite. I just wish he'd have stayed one more year so he could have been the second winningest manager in all time. But third ain't too bad, Tony. But Tony, it's great to see you. I salute you with a wonderful career, and Cooper's talent awaits.
Here's a man who knows Cooper's talent. Go ahead, Tony.
Thank you, Milo. I remember prospect. And I know you were a really nice man. I thought that was kind of a harsh thing for you to say. But, no, seriously, you know, Milo is revered every place, but in 28 years in Houston, he can do no wrong. The closest he ever came to pushing the envelope, we would play the playoff games. And I was with the Cardinals. Cardinals and Astros do not like each other, fans do not like the Cardinals, vice versa. So all of a sudden I'd come out there and Milo would say, hey, here's my good friend, and he's up on my going. It wouldn't boo Milo, but they would be really, really quiet. You had more courage, you had more guts and brains to do that.
Thank you, Tony.
You know a lot of people, man.
And the Goose. I was only privileged to announce his games for 1 year. That was with the Pirates. He'd been a relief pitcher with the White Sox. Chuck Tanner knew him well, and he became a relief pitcher, much like Tony did with Eckersley. And that just propelled me in a fabulous year that year, like a 1.62 ERA, made most appearances of any reliever. He was fabulous. And I think you'll always say, boy, making me a reliever got you to Cooperstown. And Goose, it's great to see you here tonight, and congratulations on your award tonight.
Banner had left, obviously, from Chicago to Pittsburgh, and I answered the phone late at night. They had the winter meetings down in Florida, and I think in Miami that year, and I answered the phone. It was real late in Colorado, and about 11 o'clock, and I answered the phone, and he goes, Goose. And I said, yes. He said, this is Chuck. I said, Chuck who? He said, Chuck Tanner, damn it. He said, we traded for you, and you're back in the bullpen. So, you know, I'll speak later, but Milo, you're one of the best, and you deserve to be in the Hall of Fame, and a great career, buddy, and you look great. Thank you.
Thank you, Goose. Great to have you here.
This is the man. This is the legend. Well, I'm going to give Milo the final word. You called Aaron's all of his home runs with the Atlanta Ball Club. The 715th gets played all the time. We hear it constantly, a minimum 10, 12 times a year. You did so much. You're at age 85, as Goose said, you look fabulous. You're still on the air. I don't know what else to say, but thanks for everything you've done for us. And you now have the stage, my friend.
I want to thank you, Tom. He's one of my pups. When he came to town, he kind of looked at me for help and advice. And look what happened. He's a huge success in everything. But I want to thank especially, you know, my great friends in this city are Don and Dorothy Carinci. And many of you know him and the White Sox family. They aren't with us tonight. We've been friends for over 50 years. And they're already in Florida for their winter home, and are they glad looking at the weather tonight. But their daughter, Bonnie's here, and her sister Kim, my goddaughter, wasn't able to make it tonight. And Bonnie's husband, Matt, and they've been guiding me around and picking me up and taking me every place. I just wish Don and Dorothy were here because those are friends in baseball, and we all have great friends in baseball. And I think, Tony, you probably knew them when you were with the White Sox. terrific people, and they've been a godsend to me over the years and my wife, and it's just been fabulous to know them. So I'm thinking of them tonight, and I wish they were out there because they've been a lot to baseball with the White Sox. And Tommy, I want to thank you for calling me and telling me you're going to honor me here tonight. You know, I used to MC this once in a while. Never as good as you're doing tonight, though, Tom. And then I only take cash. And the last year I did, we honored Mary Frances Beck. That was the year that I left. So I have great memories of this town. I have great memories of the Cubs and White Sox and DePaul and Northwestern. This town was great to me, and it was still my town coming from Iowa, where we thought Chicago was the end of the world. And when I got here, I didn't know it, but it was. So, but after going to Houston, it wasn't too shabby. I've been there 28 years. I love it still. Baseball, I don't care what they say, you can have all the others. They play once a week or three times a week. We play every night. We've got the greatest game. It's the most unpredictable game. I love this game, and I still do, and that's why I'm going to stay active. You stay active. Support these Cubs. Support these White Sox. And make this Pitch and Hit Club everything it's been every year for 67 years. Thank you, Tommy! The voice, smile!